Okay, so if we can get started. We're here today to honor Kurt Meinert, who is quite literally a giant in the field of clinical trials. I'm Doug Jabs. I'm the current director of the Center for Clinical Trials and Evidence Synthesis. And I first met Kurt in 1987 when he and I responded to an RFA to do clinical trials and epidemiology on the ocular complications of AIDS. And that started what turned out to be a 25-year collaboration through five clinical trials and a very long cohort study. And it actually transformed my career, because prior to that, I hadn't done any clinical trials. And now I'm basically known for doing clinical trials. So he's had a profound influence on my life, and certainly my career. We're going to hear today from various people who have been influenced by him, and they're going to talk about what it's like working with him, what it was like, his impact on the field, and what it was like being trained by him. And so hopefully we will all hear really what a great person he was. I wanna ask David Celentano, who's the chair of the Department of Epidemiology, to make some opening remarks. And we do need to thank the department. They are the ones who have sponsored this activity. And so, David, I want to personally thank you.
So you're going to hear from folks who worked with the big guy, who were taught by him, who collaborated with him. I was the person he came to when he was pissed off. And what I loved about my interactions with Kurt is I knew that Kurt was going to be upset about something. Usually it was technology related. But I knew that, after he sort of flustered and made all kinds of noises, that we'd have a great time. And we always did. He was an amazing guy to work for. I met Kurt when he came over from the University of Maryland to the department. And that must have been around the same time that you were referring to for the SOCA. And it was really a profound experience and an amazing set of studies that went on and on and on and really defined the ocular complications of HIV. I don't want to take too much of your time. I do want to pass on greetings from our dean, Ellen McKenzie, who had to go to a last minute meeting in New York, but she sends her greetings. We tried to do this program 2 years ago, and Kurt refused to let us honor him in public. That was the kind of guy he was. He wasn't into that. It's sort of hard to do it afterwards, but it's okay, because I'm seeing faces I haven't seen in 20 plus years. So it's really amazing that people have a real feeling for Kurt. I mean, he defined the field. He wrote the book. We all have his dictionary. Those of us who do trials, we have his dictionaries. We use them on a daily basis. And he really, I think, was one of the leaders in the field of clinical trials and public health. So I want to welcome you all. It's wonderful to honor Kurt and all of his students. And I will point out that prior Dean Clagg is with us today. Mike, thanks for coming. Let's have a great afternoon. Thank you.
So our first speaker is Robert Wise, who's a professor of medicine at the Johns Hopkins, and who's an expert in pulmonary medicine. He does clinical trials for his research portfolio, and he's been doing trials for a long time with members of the center, particularly Janet Holbrooks, who was a protege of Kurt's. He had opportunity to work with Kurt at the beginning of some of these trials, and he's going to talk today about what it was about Kurt and about what it was like working with him.
Well, I want to thank you very much. It's of course an honor to be asked to do this. So Kurt, as you know, was the founder of the Johns Hopkins Center for Clinical Trials. He died just about a week before his 89th birthday. And as I say that, I think of what Kurt once said to me. He said, you know, you only have one birthday. All the rest are anniversaries of your birthday. And it was that precision of thought and words that really joined me to Kurt. He was a statistician, a biostatistician, or probably from Minnesota, he would say a biometrometrist. But his métier, his media, was not numbers so much as words and ideas. He portrayed himself as a farmer from Sleepy Eye. And said that everybody is from somewhere, and I am from Sleepy Eye. More accurately, from a farm near Sleepy Eye, but it is too many words and most people want to know. Now, that was the first time, this is in Kurt's memoir, it was the first time I heard him say, I'm from a farm near Sleepy Eye. So I thought I would actually investigate this a little bit. And here is Kurt's birth certificate. And if you look at the circle up there, you can see that he was really born in Prairieville, Minnesota. Now, Prairieville is a suburb of Sleepy Eye. Here is the map. You can see that that Prairieville has about is about 34 square miles, and it has currently about 340 people, which even in my head I can figure out is one person per square mile in Prairieville. And then down at the corner, if you look here, there is Sleepy Eye. That's the big city next to Prairieville. And I've often thought Sleepy Eye has a current population of about 3,200 people. And I've often thought that the reason Kurt said he was from Sleepy Eye was really that he wanted to project that he was born in the big city. But Kurt, has been said already, he wrote the book on clinical trials. And those of us know he wrote many books on clinical trials. I think he wrote six separate textbooks and, of course, the dictionary of clinical trials. He basically set the tone for everything that we do in clinical trials through his many memos and his blogs and his listservs and his emails. And this is all consolidated in his website, Trials Meinert's Way, which is a website that I hope and pray will become memorialized probably in the history of medicine. And I'm making a plea here that the Department of Epidemiology or the Center for Clinical Trials make sure that nobody else gets to take over the website and turn it into a social media site. But Kurt set up the way that we do clinical trials. I work, as was said, with Janet Holbrook and Elizabeth Sugar for the Data Coordinating Center for the American Lung Association Clinical Research Network. But he was instrumental in the way we look at the documents, the way we set up rooms when we do clinical trial meetings. You know, he was when we have a meeting which is deliberative, like a steering committee meeting, we set it up as a hollow square because that's the way that Kurt said we should do it, so that everybody can look at everybody else and there's nobody who seems to be in charge of the group. And when we have a training meeting, we set it up like a classroom with chairs and desks in front of people so that people understand that this is a training meeting and that's what they're there for. And during breaks and dinners, luncheons, we set it up like a wedding with tables of 8 people so that all of the in-laws can work out all their difficulties with each other in between the meeting. But I want to tell you a story. Some of you may have heard this about what Kurt means to me personally and how he got my career started. I had worked as a site investigator for a couple of clinical trials with a group of very prominent people who were much more advanced than me. And this group decided that they needed to do another trial. And they looked around the room and they saw me and they said, Bob, I think you should be the one to write the grant application for that trial, because you're the one that has the most time on your hands. So, of course, this was a great opportunity for me, and I accepted the challenge. But then one of my collaborators, who some of you may know, Sonia Buse from Oregon, came up to me, and I think she thought better of it, and she said to me, now, Bob, you have to make sure that you have Kurt Meinert look over what you've written. Okay, and she was very stern about that. And I knew Kurt a little bit. And in those days, some of you may remember this, the research strategy part of a grant was not the 12 pages it is today, it was 20 pages. And when you printed it out double spaced, it was 40 pages. So I took this document with 40 pages, this thick, brought it over to Kurt, who I knew just a little bit. And I said, would you mind taking a look at this for me? And he kind of gruffly said, sure. So anyway, I was expecting the grant to come back with some anodyne comments like nice try or good job and a few of my Oxford commas removed and some of my errant capitalization changed. But Kurt must have spent the next 4 or 5 days going over that document, because when it came back to me about a week later, every single page, every sentence was marked up, changed, rearranged, reorganized. The vocabulary was changed. I couldn't say study, I had to say trial. I couldn't say patient, I had to say participant, and on and on. My most beautiful prose in paragraphs, he just X'd out the whole paragraph. When I had some sort of self-congratulatory statements like, nobody has ever shown this before, he would cross it out with a comment something like, this is not only immodest, but it's also probably untrue. So I took it to heart and I rewrote the grant. It actually got funded. And the study eventually turned out to be a negative trial. And we got it published in a very prestigious journal up in New England. And even as I say that to you, what I'm thinking is, first of all, Kurt wouldn't let me say I wrote a grant. He would want me to say I wrote an application for a grant. The grant is what you want to get, not what you're writing. And when I said the trial was negative, and that's probably the language we used, he would have said, no, Bob, a positive trial is one where the treatment helps. A negative trial is one where the treatment harms. What you had was nothing happened. You had a null trial. And that kind of precision of words, which underlay his precision of thought, has stuck with me throughout my career. And having gotten that grant, after my application really set me off, as it has so many people here, for many years of happiness doing clinical trials. Now, Kurt doesn't go away. He kind of lives in your head. And there are a number of things that bother me after knowing Kurt Miner that never used to bother me before. I get very upset when there's a document and there are no page numbers, or even worse, where there are page numbers, but they're not serial from beginning to end, or where they're hidden behind a staple. I get troubled when I see a table in a document with more than six columns, or one that's in landscape format. I sometimes write tables in landscape format, but I have serious feelings of guilt. And then, probably the worst of all, because I do sit on a number of data and safety monitoring committees, which Kurt would call treatment effect monitoring committees, and I won't explain about that, but where you just get hundreds and hundreds of pages of raw SAS output in 8-point font, and you can see I'm wearing my glasses, and it's terrible to have to read through that. But unfortunately, that's the way that so many people do it. Now, there are also a lot of words that Kurt wouldn't let me use, or if I do use them occasionally, again, I feel guilty. Subject, we don't have a monarchy here, at least not yet. It should be a participant, okay? Intervention. We don't have it. An intervention is when one country invades another, that really it should be a treatment. Blinding. Well, you know, he did a lot of eye studies, and of course, that's anathema, so we say masking. Loss to follow up or dropouts. These are terrible words because they're imprecise. We don't know whether the patient has really been lost, or they just have withdrawn consent for some part of the trial. So we shouldn't use those terms. Informed consent, that's special. Because informed in this context, think of it, it's a little bit of a weasel word, right? Does it mean that I informed the patient or the participant? Or does it mean the participant was informed and understood the aspects of the trial? So Kurt would always make us say written consent or just plain consent. And then one of the things that he taught me was that there are certain words he called fighting words. And when you're deliberating on a trial and someone says that would be malpractice or that's unethical, Kurt said, that just means they don't have any better arguments, and they're probably wrong, okay? And I have observed that over time, that's been the case. Now, there are also activities that annoy me. First of all, if there's ever a meeting without an agenda, it gets me very nervous. Again, meeting in a conference room that has a long, narrow table where people can't see each other and the acoustics are bad, it is very bothersome. And we always make sure that we use a round or a hollow square seating arrangement when we have meetings, and we have adequate microphones if the acoustics are not adequate. And then finally, I get troubled when I see staple documents that are not aligned. And as you all know, this was almost a revolt in the School of Public Health, where the dean put out some staple documents and the pages were not straight and the staples were not rectilinear to the end. And I also think of Kurt, I don't send many letters nowadays, but the other day I was sending a letter And I really took some time to make sure that the stamp was aligned to the edge of the envelope, because Kurt taught me that if your stamp is not aligned, people who get the letter think you didn't care. And so he's always in my head. So finally, I just want to thank Kurt. He set me off on my career. He was a wonderful man, we'll miss him, we will always appreciate him. But I have to tell you, we hold him in blessed memory, which is the way my tradition celebrates people, because he lives on in the hearts and the minds and the language of everybody who participates in this enterprise of running clinical trials. Finally, I want to give a very special thanks to Jill Meinert, who's perhaps one of his greatest legacies for us. Jill works with us at the Center of Clinical Trials, and she carries on his tradition of precision, thoughtfulness, and hard work. So thank you, Jill. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Bob. It's going to be a tough act to follow. So the next speaker is Janet Wittes. She's currently the principal at Wittes LLC. From 1983 through 1989, she was the chief of the biostatistics research branch at the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute at NIH. And then she was the president and, I believe, founder of Statistics Collaborative, which she formed in 1990 and worked at up until recently. She also was the, I believe, second editor of Controlled Clinical Trials, where the journal at the time of the Society for Clinical Trials, and Kurt was the founder of that journal and the first editor. So she had an opportunity to be passed on a piece of work from Kurt. She's well known to all of you in the field of clinical trials. She's well known as a trialist and as a statistician relating about trials. I've had the opportunity to work with Janet on as the head of a treatment effects monitoring committee. And she really was terrific. So Janet, thank you very much for coming and to speak with us today about sort of Kurt and his contributions to the field.
Well, thank you, Doug, for inviting me to do this. And to those of you who are here, I'm delighted to see so many of you whom I know, and lots of faces that I don't. I'm totally amused by Bob's talk, because you're going to see there's so much of overlap between what he said in such a wonderful way and what I will try to say in my own way. First, the guy from Sleepy Eye. Sleepy Eye was a very important part of Kurt, as Bob made clear. And Kurt cared a lot about language, as Bob made clear. He would not like the way I spelled guy or I. He would say, "Don't you know how to spell anything, Janet? You're so careless." But what I want to do, rather than talk about the contributions, although implicit in what I say will be contributions, is ask myself, as I was trying, I mean, Doug knows, I would say, why do you want me to talk? I don't know how to do this. What was it in Kurt's background, and I didn't really know Kurt all that well, that made him so important, that made him write a dictionary? In fact, one of the last things he wrote or said was, "Why should I write a dictionary?" So I thought about why was Kurt so grounded in Sleepy Eye? And this piece is a little story about me, but it's really about him. When I was having my garden designed, I live in DC, and we have a little tiny garden in the back. The person who was designing the garden said to me, "I want to take you to where there are rocks, and I want you to choose the rocks for the garden." I said, I don't want to choose rocks. Just get me some rocks. And she said, no, you have to come with me and choose the rocks. So I said, okay. So we went to some place in Maryland and there were lots and lots of rocks all over in different piles. And we went from pile to pile to pile. I don't like those rocks. I don't like those. And I got to one pile that looked kind of like this. And I said, boy, I like those rocks. And the rock guy said, you're from Connecticut. And I said, how do you know? And he said that people, they choose any flower. They don't care where the flowers come from. They choose any trees, any grasses, but rocks are what grounds them. And Kurt, I think, was grounded in Sleepy Eye. We really didn't talk to each other before, but here is my map of Sleepy Eye. And what strikes me about this map is not only that Sleepy Eye is, oh, first of all, let me tell you, when Kurt used to talk about Sleepy Eye, I thought he made it up. I thought it was like some silly thing that he made up and to make us think that he came from a little place. And it was only relatively recently, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, that I learned the Sleepy Eye was really a place. That was really where he was from, or as Bob said, a little bit away from Sleepy Eye. But the other thing, if you notice, and again, this is, you'll see my next map, Connecticut, it's very, the streets are parallel. They're very straight. And maybe the straightness of the sense that you could control your environment, the sense that the environment was yours to decide where it went. Maybe that's what leads somebody to write a dictionary. Because if you come from a place like this, this is Fairfield County where I grew up, the roads are all over the place, they're windy, there's rivers, there's hills, you can't control the environment. So to me, that's part of Kurt. He came from this place that sounds fake, but it was real. He comes from a place that controls things, and he cares, as Bob says, deeply about language and about choice of words and spelling. The other thing I think you all heard him say is pigs is pigs. I never knew what he meant by pigs is pigs. I thought he made it up, just like I thought he made up Sleepy Eye. And I decided, if I'm going to talk about Kurt, I better find out where pigs is pigs comes from. It's not from Minnesota. It turns out it's from a story in 1905 by an author I'd never heard of, Ellis Parker Butler, who is talking about how much you charge for pigs when you're on the railroad. So what it's this chapter piece says, pigs is pigs, Mike Flannery declared firmly. Guinea pigs or Dago pigs, we wouldn't say that anymore, or Irish pigs is all the same to the Interurban Express Company and to Mike Flannery. The nationality of pigs creates no differentiality in the rate, Mr. Morehouse. That was what pigs is pigs is, that things were, they may have looked different, but they're really the same. There was a little twist in this because Mr. Morehouse said there was an issue about the way in which bureaucracies work. And that, so there's two levels of pigs is pigs. One is Mike Flannery, pigs are pigs, wherever they're from. And the other is bureaucracy has silly rules, both of which are very much like what Kurt believed. So I believe Kurt was really grounded in who he was and where he came from. Where he came from, as I say, and as Bob said, was Sleepy Eye. He cared a lot about the people he loved. And I think we all of us who knew him, even those of us who didn't know him well, knew about his kids, his wife. They were so much part of him. And he wasn't bashful about saying that. Lots of people keep their family separate. Kurt, it was clear who he loved and who was important to him. What he cared about intellectually, what he cared about personally, he told us. What he believed, he told us. Sometimes he told us in ways that we didn't agree with, but he told us what he believed. And he wasn't bashful about telling us. But also, he wasn't, well, he could be insistent, you know, just demanding, this is how you do. And as Bob gave examples, you couldn't say patient. You had to say participant. I find myself, the other thing he did, he hated, maybe that's the wrong word. I have to be more careful in my choice of words. He didn't like it, or he objected to, maybe that's what I should say. He objected to anthropomorphizing things. So if you said, the study planned to do this, he would say, no, the study did not plan. The people who designed the study planned to do this. And I find myself, when I'm writing, if I anthropomorphize, I find myself saying, could I face Kurt with a sentence like this? He was very opinionated. And I think all of us who dealt with him knew that. And again, he wasn't bashful about telling his opinion to you, to an audience, to the journals. And he could even be cantankerous. The word that Bob used was gruff, or maybe it was you, Doug, who used it. So one of you used gruff. He could be that. And so I first met him, I think, in 1970 or maybe 71, when I was postdocing for Jerry Kornfield. And Jerry would drag me to meetings. And two of the studies were the UGDP and the CDP, the Coronary Drug Project, both of which Kurt was involved with, and for both studies, Kurt was present. I don't remember them very much at all. I remember being very scared and shy. And I do remember this big guy sitting there. Whenever he said something, everybody listened. But that was my only relationship with him early. Later on, 10 years later, when I went to NHLBI, that's when I began to know him. But the important thing I want to stress was that he always listened to others. Sometimes he listened and you could see him thinking, I don't agree. But he could change his mind. And when he changed his mind, he would admit that. He wasn't afraid of changing his mind and admitting it. So what are the qualities of being grounded and caring deeply? And other qualities that he had, like intelligence and warmth and sense of humor. He had lots of qualities. It gave him license to explore and create. And as you all know, he was instrumental in the growth of clinical trials as a field. His talks, his textbooks, and you've seen pictures of a bunch of them. His founding of controlled clinical trials. So the journal came before the society. It was his journal. And his central role, and I'm amused by this, I was going to correct it, but then I decided not to. His central role in establishing the Society for Clinical should be capital T with an S. This is a typo. He would not have tolerated this. And the dictionary. And as I said, the dictionary, I think, is really important. And to me, I want to go back to sleepy eyes and the orthogonal street. Why define words? Because you have control over them and because you can define them. So when did I learn that Kurt was a gentle giant? I mean, I was, as I say in the beginning, I mean, he's, for those of you who know him, who knew him, the tense is always hard. Those of you who knew him, you know that he was, when he sat in a room, you knew he was there. For those of you who didn't know him, you should also know that. Kurt was a presence when he was in a room. And for those of us who were kind of shy, it was kind of, you know, and he would say things with a definiteness and an opinionatedness that was very definite. So he founded Controlled Clinical Trials in 1980, and he was the editor-in-chief until 1993. The journal became pretty soon after 1980, maybe 1981, became the Journal of the Society for Clinical Trials, and he was one of the founders of that society. In the early 1990s, the Society for Clinical Trials wanted control of the journal because they said, it's our journal. It's not Kurt's journal and it's not Hopkins' journal. It's our journal. Kurt was not happy about that. And he wasn't shy about telling us or telling everybody. I wasn't involved in these conversations, but I heard about them, that he did not want to relinquish the editorship. And the journal, the group at Clinical Trial at the Society asked me to be the editor. And I said, look, I'm honored to become the editor, but I'm really nervous about what Kurt's going to say to me and how Kurt's going to treat me. I'm taking away his baby. So I was very torn, but I said, okay, I'll do it, but you guys have to protect me if Kurt is really angry. Well, there was no need to be nervous. We talked. He was gracious. He was helpful. He was peeved. I mean, he made it very clear he was peeved, but he separated that at least he didn't express it, but I think he would have if he were peeved at me. He didn't express that anger at me. Rather, he wanted the journal to be healthy and to grow, and he would do anything he could to help me, but he made it clear that he wished that this hadn't happened. So he was terrific, and I'm so grateful. Those 5 years that I was a journal editor, I was dependent on him a lot. And I thought it was really gracious and generous of him to treat me that way. And I want to finish with, and again, it's kind of interesting that both Bob and I started with Sleepy Eye and ended up with Trials Minor Tway. Musings and Rants. And this is about the stable. I think the best thing for those of you who didn't know him, to hear his words. For those of you who did know him, you probably remember this. So this is his words exactly. In coordinating centers, aside from counting, stapling is among the most important things people do. The triggering point for the protocol was a mailing from the dean's office in late 2004 with an attachment carelessly stapled. I figured, I of course being Kurt, that if the medical school was number one in US News and World Report, that here in the School of Public Health, we should be number one in stapling. So here's the stapling program, and it's with two pages. Whereas one, stapling is a learned skill. Two, practice makes perfect. Three, sloppy stapling reflects badly on the entire operation. Four, slop begets slop. Pigs is pigs, remember? And five, the dean's office sets the standard for the school. Therefore, it follows that you, Al Sarber, he sent it to her, Al, as head stapler of the institution, have the potential of bringing the entire institution down if slop in stapling in your office is contagious and ultimately affects all operations of the school. Hence, it is imperative that you and everyone else in your office follow a strict stapling protocol. So there is Kurt in his cantankerous, bluff, opinionated self. But as Bob said, you could, even when he argued with you, he could turn on a dime. And here were his last words on stapling. Happy stapling and have a nice day. So thank you, Kurt, for all that you taught us all, that you taught us you could be opinionated, strong, you could disagree with people, but basically we were all on the same team, we're all trying to do the same thing, and it's important to be able to express ourselves in ways that are meaningful and true to ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet. That was terrific. So the third talk for today is from Gillian Grisham, who was a PhD student here and was actually apparently Kurt's last PhD student he advised. And she is now an assistant professor at Cedars-Sinai Medical Center in Los Angeles. And she actually continued to work with Kurt after she graduated because she was an associate editor on the book that Kurt and Steve Piantedosi edited, Practice Principles of Clinical Trials textbook. She could not be with us today, but she recorded her talk and we're going to have a video presentation now. And I believe she's actually here online. So Gillian, thank you.
My name is Gillian Grisham, and I am a past doctoral student from the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health in the Clinical Trials and Evidence Synthesis track. It is a great honor to be able to speak today and pay tribute to Dr. Miner, a wonderful mentor, colleague, and dear friend of mine. I am sorry that I cannot be there with you in person today for this important event. As some of you may know, we recently welcomed our beautiful baby daughter into the family, who has kept us very busy and prevented me from traveling to join you today. Pictured here is perhaps a slightly less sleep-deprived and younger version of myself as a graduate student alongside my mentor, Dr. Miner, at what he called the Big Dance, or Graduation Day. I had the immense honor of being one of Dr. Miner's graduate, or gradual students, as he would say. It turns out that I was in fact his last gradual student, and I feel very lucky that I continue to stay in touch with him and work with him later on as a colleague and friend. It is difficult to put into words today the impact that he has had on my life, as well as countless others over the years. His teachings and lessons reach beyond those whom he directly advised or taught to a much larger and broader audience through his volumes of textbooks and dictionaries, his research articles, and what many may also be familiar with, his postings on his website, trialsminersway.com. Something many of us students, as well as a long list of his peers, including trialists, epidemiologists, biostatisticians, and other medical professionals look forward to, were his emails, which included attachments to memos of trial-related topics and lessons, musings and rantings, and excerpts of his life stories. I often refer back to these postings for different reasons, including for my own teaching. There is something new that I stumble upon each time, uncovering new treasures and glimpses into his interesting and unique perspective on trials and life. One of his most recent posts that he circulated was titled Things I Miss. Some things on his list included classroom teaching, mentoring, and in-person meetings. I really love this piece, and since he sent it around, have found myself often thinking about the things that I miss most about him. I reached out and compiled the thoughts from other students of his, colleagues, family members, and friends, who also shared with me the things that they missed most and lessons learned from him, both on trials and in life. While the list could go on forever, here are a few things that we wanted to mention today. Of course, one of the first things that was raised numerous times by many different people were his farm analogies. As most people know, Dr. Miner was a farmer from Sleepy Eye, Minnesota, and had a special fondness for pigs. He describes reasons for this in one of his memos shown here. Most people have heard him say his favorite quote, "Pigs is pigs and data is data," which he used to remind students and colleagues that the word data is plural. Over the years, people sent him toy pigs as gifts, and he ended up with quite the collection in his office and home. Another favorite quote of his was, "Too many pigs under the same blanket," which he often reminded us, especially when writing papers. He actually tried to convince me to get a pig after I moved onto a farm property outside of Los Angeles, although he would raise his eyebrow and say that that wasn't a real thing. While I never did get a pig, I did have chickens, which he was very amused by, The first thing he did was have me read an excerpt from his stories from Klinkapunk book, The Chicken Drive, another life lesson based on his experience as a farmer raising chickens in Sleepy Eye. He also had me read his favorite books, The Little Red Hen and Chicken Little, as some of the required readings for his graduate students. While not necessarily farm-related, Dr. Minard had a repertoire of other animal analogies, including alligators and swamps, cats, and the albatross. He also enjoyed sharing sports analogies and quotes with us. Many of his classic expressions are repeated frequently to this day, and a reminder that he was right all along. Dr. Minard was more than a teacher. He was a mentor, a colleague, a friend, a cheerleader, as he called himself. And most importantly, he always believed in his students. I experienced that firsthand as well, as I'm sure the other 27 of his mentees did over the years. It is what got us to the big dance and helped us succeed in our professions. Many of us continue to pursue trial-related fields and academic careers. He also taught us to relax and have fun while doing it. A past student and now faculty member in the CCT, Dr. Shariza Bashk, expressed that Dr. Minard will be remembered by his ability to foster a community and serve as a mentor with whomever he worked with, regardless of age, rank, or expertise. He always valued what people brought to the conversations and their lived experiences that backed it up. Another past student, Dr. Chris Zeekley, shared that despite all the rules, structure, and boundaries he established, he was able to see that each and every one of us students were capable and had a place in the world and could succeed. He was able to meet us at our level and work with the very different skills that each one of us had, even if those skills might not be traditional or valued by others. He has set an example, inspired the future generation of trialists to do the same. Some of the things most people who knew Dr. Minard missed most were the conversations they shared with him, preferably in person or over the telephone. The conversations could last hours and usually included arguments or debates over trials, farms, BS, as he'd say, or whatever else came to mind. He would go off on some seemingly unrelated topic, only to bring it back to teach us all a new way of looking at things. He knew how to make learning challenging, but also fun, a rare gift, as shared by one of his colleagues, Bonnie Pianodosi. The best conversations occurred before the meetings even started. He had a great sense of humor, and his banter with his colleagues were always so entertaining. There have been so many stories shared by his colleagues and students of meetings and site visits full of laughter and great memories. There was never a dull moment with Dr. Minard. He also liked to make a point when arguing. He once walked his graduate student, Chris Seekley, around the School of Public Health and took pictures of her next to the trash cans as a protest to the size of the new cans that were being installed. He wanted to use her as a human reference measurement to show the administration how large the cans really were. The administration didn't know, however, that he had found the shortest student at the school for reference and had introduced a major bias. Dr. Minard would strike conversations with anyone he came across with a genuine curiosity and desire to get to know them, whether it was at the school, in his neighborhood, or in the taxi. He would say that you can learn something from everyone you meet. Dr. Minard had a strong passion for writing and often communicated his thoughts to his students and other trialists through his collection of teachings, life lessons, musings and rants, and creative stories, all posted to his website. Through these, he taught us the importance of clear and concise writing and storytelling, as Dr. Ian Saldana shared. Not only did he provide lessons in the art of writing, but also everything that goes along with it. This includes how to format the tables to accompany the writing, set up the page, or the scaffolding, as he called it, and even how to staple the pages. You can find his stapling protocol and the Tables 101 series on his website, in case you are curious or need a reminder. He frequently sent out thought-provoking questions or tables that included counts of trials, most often of the clinicaltrials.gov registration data, to understand the characteristics and trends of trials and make sense of the numbers. His memos were sparked by his profound curiosity and observations of clinical trials. The memos were enjoyed for their detail, language, and relevance, along with the perky humor that went with them, all tied together with his underlying common basis of humility and honest introspection, highlighting them all, as one of his colleagues shared. He also wrote numerous textbooks, including the well-known Clinical Trials textbook, Design Conduct and Analysis, which continues to be used in classrooms and trial courses to this day. One fun fact is he actually built a shed, which is pictured here, for each edition of the textbook he wrote, as well as one for his trials dictionary. He happened to be a very talented woodworker. Dr. Meinert was extremely precise in his language and the use of trial language, to be specific. He called himself a wordologist and would get quite irritated if a certain word or expression was misused. One example of that is his birthday. He always reminded us that you cannot wish someone happy birthday, but that you should wish them a happy anniversary of their birth. I chuckled when I thought about this, giving birth to my own daughter a couple of months ago. I've heard stories that Dr. Meinert would even travel around with a dictionary under the seat of his car. If there was a debate about a particular word or its use, he would pull the dictionary out right then and there and have the person read it out loud. He has quite the collection of musings and rants about words that irritate him, such as real-world trials, interventional studies, and of course, data used in singular form. Many students and colleagues of Dr. Meinert's remember him for his scientific and methodologic rigor. As Dr. Jimmy Lane noted, he wasn't just a giant in science, his impact went beyond that. He reminded his students of how crucial trials are in pushing medicine forward and in making real differences in people's lives. His absolute commitment to doing trials the right way from start to finish is something that students should try to live by. We need to embrace the high standards set by Dr. Meinert in clinical trials, understanding that his contributions are not just historical footnotes, but living principles that drive our current research activities. Dr. Meinert approached everything he did with great rigor and precision. He often reminded us that if it is not documented, it did not happen. A lesson for researchers and trialists that should be carried forward to future generations of students. Another lesson he emphasized was show me the data, as his daughter Jill reminded me of the other day. Don't make judgments based on words or appearance alone. Always do your own research and gather data needed to make an informed decision. He taught us how to count everything twice and to approach every task with great detail and thoughtfulness. Dr. Meinert always said that counting is the hardest thing to do. I also learned this firsthand when working with him to count the registration data on some of our later projects together. He was extremely thorough when reviewing our work, be it DSMB charters, dissertations, or scientific papers, reading one sentence at a time and scrutinizing each and every word. His series of good practices, policies, and procedures for trials has been especially useful, covering everything from study startup to forms design, data collection, analysis, and the reporting and publication of trials. I know that many of us still follow and use these protocols to this day. In the words of Bonnie Pianodosi, so many people have benefited from Dr. Meinert's wisdom and accomplishments. The world is in a much better place because of him. He had a positive impact on the lives of so many people. Not only students and colleagues, but thousands of patients have been protected by a scientific rigor. His legacy is one of scientific integrity and a prolific body of work that defined the field of clinical trials. Something else that I will always miss are his bets. Dr. Meinert loved a good bet. While he would never bet more than one US dollar, he very much enjoyed the negotiations leading up to the bet, as well as the celebration and gloating that followed if he won, which happened a lot. He often thought of clever ways to trick the other bettor into making what he called a bad bet. One of his missions, in addition to having me graduate with a doctoral degree, was to teach me the art of betting. Bets were often over sport events, such as the Super Bowl or Major League Baseball. I started to finally get the hang of betting and eventually even received a diploma on the art of betting from Dr. Meinert, signed with a dollar bill that I had won from him. I think I earned this certificate after being sly about one particular bet where I did not indicate the currency and paid him in a Canadian dollar, which was about 80 cents to the dollar. While I'm not sure I'll ever be as good of a bettor as he was, I do know for certain, and would put my money on it any day, that he was the greatest mentor anyone could ever ask for. Finally, I miss his family values and good heart. Anyone who knew Dr. Meinert would quickly recognize how much he valued family and really learning about his colleagues and students and their families as well. He would spend a lot of time during meetings asking questions about their life experiences, who they are as people, and why they're interested in the things they do. His textbooks were filled with dedications to his family, and most of his stories involve the adventures that he shared with his family, including his daughters, his wife, and grandchildren. He also worked along his daughter Jill for many years. They would have weekly lunches in his office, which she shared with me is something that she missed the most. Expressed by many, not only is Dr. Miner considered the father of clinical trials, but he's also a father figure to so many students and colleagues. One of the most special and impactful things that I was able to work on with Dr. Meinert was a family effort which involved Dr. Meinert, his daughter Jill, my dad, and myself. Collaborating on this project and publishing these father-daughter papers will forever be a highlight of my career. I feel fortunate to have gotten to know his family over the years, and also had the pleasure of meeting his wonderful wife, Susie Meinert. When Mrs. Meinert sadly passed away several years ago, Dr. Meinert asked me to play one of his favorite songs on the violin at his wife's memorial service. Going back to his farm roots, this was a song called Cattle Call, performed by Eddie Arnold. Thus, to honor him today, my dad and I recorded Cattle Call with my dad on guitar and myself on violin to accompany a short slideshow of pictures of him. I'm hoping that Dr. Meinert and Susie are dancing and yodeling along to it as it plays. There is truly no one like Dr. Meinert. He is unique, creative, kind, passionate, inquisitive, and an extraordinary trialist. I miss him deeply, but know that he lives on through his life's achievements, the connections he made with so many people, and the pathway he has forged for trialists and for students. Thank you, Dr. Meinert, for everything.
Well, that was amazing. And really, Jillian, if you're online, that was just a spectacular talk. Really, I think the entire audience is sort of sitting here wrapped and spellbound. So thank you very much. That concludes the talks for today. There is a reception next door for everybody, and I welcome you to stay and chat and talk to everybody and reminisce about Kurt and really all of the wonderful things he's done for the field of clinical trials and for Johns Hopkins. Thank you.